Hello students, myself Dr. Manoj Kumar Sharma. I am teaching in Rajiv Gandhi National University of Law, Patiala. I am teaching constitutional law. Today we shall be dealing with the topic judicial appointments and accountability. The topic we will be trying to find out the position regarding the procedure and appointment of judges of the higher judiciary, that is High Court and Supreme Court in India, to compare it with the position in US and Australia, to examine and understand the need and importance of ensuring accountability among the higher judiciary, and finally to understand the impact of Judicial Appointments Commission in 2014 and the impact of 99th Constitutional Amendment Act 2014. My scheme of presentation will be, first of all, I need to introduce the topic, then we will be comparing the position in US and Australia along with appointment of judges to higher judiciary under the Indian Constitution. We all know that judiciary has played a very, very relevant part, very important part in interpreting the constitutional provisions. So we will be dealing with some of the important cases of the Supreme Court of India, the reports of the Law Commission, Judicial Appointment Commission Act 2014, and 99th Constitutional Amendment Act. And finally, we will be dealing with judicial accountability and judicial independence, the relationship between these two. To begin with, judicial independence and judicial accountability is sine qua non for ensuring justice. Justice, which is our preamble objective. The Constitution of India, the preamble to that Constitution, aims at securing justice, social, economic, and political. In a country where the preamble objective is to ensure justice, it is very important that the judicial independence be ensured, and it be ensured that the judiciary is accountable to the masses. The judges be able to deliver justice, to decide cases without any fear and fervor. The independence of judiciary cannot be gainsaid in such a democratic polity as our country is. For the process, we will be dealing in the beginning with the Australian position. Students, so far as Australia is concerned, appointment of judges to higher judiciary takes place through a very detailed process. Public notices are issued by the Advocate General's Department. The Advocate General, he ventures into wide-scale consultations. The consultation process is with the AG's department, with the courts, with the federal courts, with the courts of family, with the family courts. And then after considering all the nominations which are received, a public notice is also issued wherein people can send in their nomination. They can express their interest in being appointed as members of higher judiciary. Their nominations are considered by an advisory panel, which is constituted to consider the names and to recommend to the PM and the cabinet which names are to be appointed as judges of the higher judiciary. The panel, once it's making a recommendation to the AG's office, the AG's office then gets an approval from the Prime Minister and the cabinet, and then the recommendations are sent to the Governor General for appointment as judges of the higher judiciary. Therefore, if we see the Australian position, we find that in Australia, wide consultative process is adopted for appointing the judges of higher judiciary, and it also involves issuing public notices wherefrom the opinion, the nominations from the public is received, so as to ensure judicial independence, so that no person is given a veto power in appointment of judges, such that the judicial independence can be ensured. Moving on to the position in United States of America. In US, we find that there is judiciary at the provincial level and judiciary at the federal level. So far as judiciary at the provincial level is concerned, we have justices of peace, municipal and local courts. We have state trial courts. We have courts of appeal. And then we have Supreme Courts in each states. And at the federal level, we have federal magistrates, federal courts, federal trial courts, then special purpose courts, courts of equity, circuit courts, and all, and with the US Supreme Court. So far as the appointment of federal judges is concerned, you will note that Article 2, Section 2 of the US Constitution that gives to the president the power to nominate by and with the advice and consent of the Senate to appoint judges of the Supreme Court. Therefore, the president is to nominate the members of the higher judiciary, but then he is not having the sole power. The appointment of judges of the Supreme Court, the federal Supreme Court, that is done with the advice and consent of the Senate, as you can see from Article 2, Section 2 of the Constitution of the United States of America. So far as the process is concerned, if you see Article 2, Section 4 and Article 3, Section 1, there you find that these judges can be removed only by way of impeachment proceedings, which is a very rare event. They can be removed for conviction on account of treason, bribery and other high crimes and misdemeanors. So far as appointment is concerned, if you see Article 3, Section 1, that says judicial power of these United States shall be vested in one Supreme Court and in such inferior courts as the Congress may from time to time ordain and establish. The judges, both of the Supreme and the inferior court, shall hold their office during good behavior and shall at stated times receive for their salaries, for their services, a compensation which shall not be diminished during their continuance in office. If you see and analyze the judicial position in US, you find that nomination is made by the president and then it is sent to Senate Judiciary Committee. Senate Judiciary Committee examines those persons whose names are sent to it. It votes then, after considering the names, whether these names are to be sent to the Senate for floor test or not. Once the Senate Judiciary Committee decides that the names are suitable, they are considered suitable for appointment to the federal courts, then the names are sent to the Senate and the appointment is done by the Senate. Which, if you see the procedure, we find that number one, the appointment of judges is not in the sole hand of the executive. The executive, though, can appoint the judges of the federal judiciary, but then it is required to consult. It is required to consult and get it approved from the Senate. And of course, the names are scrutinized by the Senate Judiciary Committee. Similarly, so far as removal of judges is concerned, it has been ensured under Article 3, Section 1, that they cannot be removed by an ordinary process. They cannot be removed by the executive as such. They have to be removed by the legislature, by way of impeachment, which is a very rare event. So far as their salaries are concerned, they cannot be diminished during their continuance in office. Their allowances cannot be diminished during their continuance in office. Therefore, the American Constitution ensures independence of judiciary in US. If we see the appointment of judges in provinces, we find they have adopted a unique method for the appointment of judges in the lower judiciary, in the judiciary in provinces. The appointment in almost majority of the provinces is by election. There is a varying tenure of 6 to 14 years in different provinces. They are appointed by election and the accountability is also ensured as their reappointment is dependent upon their re-election from that constituency. In some states, the elections are held on partisan lines, on party basis, whereas in other states, the elections are on non-partisan lines. But then in provinces also, independence of judiciary is ensured by ensuring that they are appointed by election. So far as the Indian position is concerned, students, you will find that appointment of high court judges is dealt within Article 217, Clause 1, which says, every judge of a high court shall be appointed by the president by warrant under his hand and seal, after consultation with the Chief Justice of India, the governor of the state, and in case of appointment of a judge other than the Chief Justice, the Chief Justice of a high court. If you go to Article 222, Clause 1, which talks about transfer of judges of a high court, it says, the president may, after consultation with the Chief Justice of India, transfer a judge from one high court to any other high court. It must be noted that so far as appointment of high court judges are concerned, the term used in Article 217 is consultation and it is not, the concurrence is not used. Therefore, it brings us to the point whether the consultation means concurrence or whether it means only consultation, which implies that the judges, the Chief Justice of India is to be consulted and such other judges are to be consulted. In the Constituent Assembly, when the Constitution was being drafted and it was being enacted, Dr. B. R. Ambedkar, when the motion was moved that the word concurrence should be replaced, should be put in for the word consultation, it was opposed in the Constituent Assembly. On the ground, as Dr. B. R. Ambedkar said, that we are not giving veto power either to the executive or to the judiciary. If we are not trusting the highest office of the president and the government officers, then we cannot give veto power to the governor as well, to the Chief Justice as well. Therefore, they said it should be consultation. It should be full and effective consultation between different constitutional functionaries, and only then the appointment of judges of high courts that should be made.